Hi everyone, this is Sasha and Suzy from Women's Fight News, and it's episode 3. I'm going to always say it to try and remember, give us like a little reminder what episodes we're on.
And it's an achievement. Suddenly we've got 3 in a row.
Yeah, we should have like a streak. How many can we get in a row until like one of us is on holiday or something?
It's going to happen next time.
I know, yeah. How has your week been, Suzy, and how have your walk runs been? That's what I really want to know.
Well, I've been going all out the last 2 days. I don't know if you noticed my percentage creeping up.
I'm not going to lie, because I've not been able to do anything yesterday and today. I've not looked because I'm frightened and I don't want it to stress me out and not sleep.
Do you want to know how much I've done?
Go on.
I did 20k yesterday and 20k today, but that's including cycling on a, you know, like an indoor cycling machine.
That's cheating. No.
It's on the list. It's on the list.
See, if I add my swims, that's going to be like 1 kilometre. Like cycling, oh, I'm going to have to buy a bike.
That was running well. It wasn't just cycling, but I was like, right, this is it. I'm becoming full-time training. So I did 2 mornings to it, literally.
It's like we're full-time athletes, but we're like virtual athletes.
it's
stressful, isn't it? I mean, obviously you went to a park run, didn't you, Saturday?
Yeah.
I then risked my life in the storms in Liverpool, and I done a walk at like the waterfront where the River Mersey is. And I mean, like, I had a hat on. Clearly, I hadn't washed my hair that day either. So I had, like, a cap on. I had a bag because I'd been shopping. And I mean, the winds were out. No one else was out. It was like a weather warning. And I was like, no, fuck this. I'm getting these kilometres in. But then on the way back, it genuinely got that dangerous. Like, signs were falling from buildings. A tree had fell.
Oh my God.
And I was like, right, I'll have to postpone my walk. I was like, but that's how serious I am taking this.
I know. This is why I've upped my game as well. We're getting really competitive. We're like messaging each other, aren't we? Like trash talk.
We won't even do any more podcasts because we would have fell out because you're cheating, cycling. We didn't agree that we could cycle on it. No one mentioned that. I'm going to get up tomorrow at like 5 a.m. I'm going to cycle 100 kilometres. I'm going to do a 20-kilometre walk and then like a little 5K run. And then a swim.
You'll be done.
And then I won't go to work because I'll be too tired.
This is the start of where everything else in our lives fall apart because we're doing this challenge.
But you know what? As long as I complete the challenge, I'm not bothered. If everything else falls apart but I complete this challenge, I've won. I'm a winner.
Be there with your medal.
That's all I want. I've not had a medal for years now. As you get older, you just don't get them, do you? So... No. I'm fighting for this medal. I've missed winning them. I'm going to hang it up and everything. It'll be like front and centre in the living room. I'll have it behind all this, like this memorabilia stuff. I'm going to move it all and just have the medal hanging up.
Just that.
just that. Get rid of all this now. That's not important. It's the medal. That medal's important to me. Speaking of winners, Skye Nicolson has become a world champion over the weekend. So Skye Nicolson defeated Sarah Mahfoud and she's claimed the WBC featherweight title. Scorecards were obviously incredibly wide. So two judges had it 100-90 and then one judge did give Sarah one round. So had it 99-91. Very wide for a world title fight. Tell us your thoughts on the fight, Suzy.
Yeah, I mean, well done to Skye. It went how I thought it would go, on points to Skye Nicolson. I just thought it was a lot wider than I was expecting it to go, actually. Mm-hmm. It was a lot more sort of one-sided than I thought it would be. But yeah, I mean, she went to Vegas. She's got herself a world title. She's got herself into a brilliant spot now with lots of potential fights coming up because I know that Eddie Hearn has come out and said that he's hoping she'll do a defence in Australia.
Mm-hmm.
And then that Raven Chapman, potentially in a 5-5, which I presume would be in Saudi Arabia. And then she's hoping, if she gets through Raven Chapman, would be the Serrano fight.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, what a weekend for Skye Nicolson. How did you find it?
Yeah, I mean, it's great. Skye's got her first world title. I think I definitely thought it'd be closer than it was. I can't quite work out whether Sarah didn't turn up on the night or Skye was just too good or a mixture of both. Because I definitely expected it to be a little bit closer than that. But a win is a win for Skye. I'm sure she's more than happy with her performance. I did message Steffi Bull to ask how likely he thinks the Raven fight will be. And he thinks it's quite likely and it's realistically going to be on that 5 versus 5 card. Because Brilliant. Raven Chapman is mandatory. So that's the fight that I want to see. I don't particularly want to see the Amanda Serrano fight, to be honest, at the minute. Also, it doesn't make any sense to me because obviously with Skye holding the WBC, she can't defend that title against Amanda.
No, so, that's true.
Yeah, it to me, none of it works. I don't think Amanda would take the fight. I know Skye says she would do the 12 threes, but then she can't defend her title. She might have to vacate that title because I'm not 100% convinced the WBC would wait for Skye to drift off. So I don't see that fight happening, but the Raven fight is the one that I want to see. 100% me all day, that one. With Skye's performance, there was a bit of showboating, as we saw kind of throughout, but definitely at the end. And I had to ask people on Twitter and Instagram what they thought of it. Before I'll go to their comments, what did you think of Skye's showboating?
To be honest, I'm never a huge fan of showboating, full stop. However, saying that, if you can showboat and get away with it and not get hit, then you know, that's just showing your skill, isn't it? If you can stand there and wiggle about and get away with it, and that's the idea, isn't it? So I guess if you can do it, why not? I'm not a huge fan, but
the end I don't of the think fight, it didn't go down that well. I think something I've noticed with Skye, like since the weekend, is either like she's a little bit like Marmite. I think with not her as a person, because I think everyone can see she's a lovely, genuine person. Yep. But I think her fight style, you either love it or hate it to watch. I think if you're a casual boxing fan, you're probably never gonna call Skye entertaining. I think people who are a little bit more into boxing and can probably appreciate the footwork and things like that will appreciate it. The showboating just didn't go down well at all, though, from what I'd read on kind of Twitter and off my social media posts and stuff like that. And I think it's like that genuine like consensus of it's probably not much point doing it. I think if you're going to do it, you've got to follow it up with something. So I quite like I said last week, Sinisa Estrada kind of calling her, you know, your caster in, and then off the back of it, she's through this unbelievable combination. Not a fan of like Ben Whisker's very guilty of it, like dancing around the ring and not doing anything. Because for me, I think, don't know how some of the rounds were scored because not a lot happened. It's all good and well showboating, but for me, you're not really controlling anything because I think it was like, there wasn't a lot being thrown at times in some of the rounds. So yeah, like I say, she's obviously got the confidence to do it, I think, which is great. She clearly had the time, so don't know what Sarah was doing. She wasn't coming forward to do anything. But for me, I think if you're going to do it, you got to follow it up with something. Got to do something. You got to throw. And I think Eddie Hearn alluded to, like, she's got to start letting her hands go. I think the punch stats were something like, I think it was 54 punches in the whole fight. I think as she's now world level, she's got to let her hands go a little bit more, in my opinion, especially if you're looking at like Raven Chapman. If you're looking at Amanda Serrano, who throws around 250 in a fight, it's a massive difference, isn't it?
And I think it's style matchups as well. With some fighters, it doesn't who they fight against. They're exciting to watch, you know, their style. With obviously, with Skye, she's excellent at what she does, isn't she? She just elusive. She doesn't get hit. The problem is how much, like you say, she does actually throw at times because she only throws what she needs to win in a way. But it's, so it depends on who she fights as to how exciting it comes across. And
yeah,
if you've
got fight
that rubbish, but with someone perhaps like Raven Chapman who strongly comes forward, I think that star matchup could be quite exciting.
Yeah, I think she will look even better the higher the level, without a doubt. Like you say, she's her footwork's impeccable, isn't it? How she moves off the back foot, it flows so nicely. It's so relaxed. But when you are talking even like the likes of a Raven Chapman, she's going to have to throw more. She's going to have to, because Raven Chapman is so good at walking opponents down, getting them on the ropes, unloading her hands. Like, I think Skye's going to have to. But like you say, whether it's in a way like choice, you know, I suppose she just does what she does to win, Skye, doesn't she? What's the point in her throwing 200 punches in a fight if she can throw 54 and win every round? So whether her style will obviously continue to adapt as the opponent's level gets better, I imagine. But it's that fine line, isn't it, of being able to like move and defend, but then knowing when to come in and attack. Someone who's not being linked, which I'm always upset about, because I think for me, before you're even entertaining Amanda Serrano, you need to get through this fighter, is Erica Cruz. For me, take away Amanda Serrano is one of the best in the divisions or around those couple of divisions. I don't know, like, I'd be calling out Erica Cruz. If you can get through Erica Cruz, that's good. That's impressive for me, because she's another one, like Amanda throws about 250 or lands, sorry, 250 punches a fight, is ruthless, got an unbelievable chin on her. Like, you want to get through her, surely, don't you, in that division?
Yeah. It's just whether she wants to come up. She's got a belt now, hasn't she, at the lower weight, whether she comes up.
But when you've got then a name like Skye, who even though she's only just won a world title, she is becoming a big name. I don't know, for me, if I'm Erica Cruz, that's potentially worth vacating a belt. Sometimes you don't always have to vacate. You know, you've got the opportunity to move up, fight for the belt, and then make that decision. But I don't know. I'd be having my eyes on the likes of Skye Nicolson, Raven Chapman, in the future for Raven, obviously, if I'm Erica Cruz, definitely. And if I'm these fighters, I'd want to call Erica out, because that's an unbelievable name to have on like your resume if you beat her. I think that's unbelievably impressive.
Yeah. I tell you who I fight, which is like, it probably won't ever happen, but it'd be such an interesting fight, would be Pasoon. Because bearing in mind, Pasoon's only sort of a weight up, but then I think she struggled to even make super feather, so I don't think she'd be coming down to feather. She's such an intense pressure fighter, how Skye would deal with that.
That's it, isn't it? And I think that is what I'm looking forward to seeing with, like, Skye, is when she is in the ring with someone like, Adelphian Pasoon would be unbelievable. Erica Cruz, when you're in the ring with someone, like, say, high pressure, high volume, high intensity, how she adapts her natural style. And I think it'll only do Skye the world of good, because obviously she's not really had to do that yet. So I suppose you can't criticise her because she's not had to do it. But when she does, it will be interesting to see how she merges her current style and footwork and defensive skills into, she is going to have to start fighting on the inside. At some point, she is going to have to let her hands go. I mean, that'll be exciting to watch, I think, then. And probably more fan-friendly, I think, with some of them opponents, potentially.
Definitely.
Are you going to sit on the fence, or would you be brave enough to pick a winner between Skye and Raven?
Oh my gosh. Do you know what? It's really hard because I really like them both. I've always been a huge fan of Raven right from the beginning. I've loved watching Skye's career and how she's developed. And they're so different, aren't they? That's the thing.
The polar opposite fighters, aren't they?
But if I was going to go for how I feel, what I like as a fan to watch, I love Raven's style.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just what I like to watch. So if I was literally just going to go for that, I'm going to go for, because I prefer that style of fighting. And I think I'm going to go for Raven.
Yeah. I think as it stands now, I would go for Raven. But I think, it's an unbelievable fight. I mean, some people were that impressed with Skye at the weekend that they're saying that she could beat Amanda Serrano, though. So I think it is very much what you like, I suppose, like you say. I'm a fan of like you, a fan of Raven style. But yeah, people, I saw loads of people on Twitter saying like Amanda wants nothing to do with Skye. Amanda couldn't cope with her footwork. Would you say, obviously, I feel like Eddie Hearn's got slightly different plans than Skye Nicolson because Skye really wants the Amanda fight. Would you say today, based off the weekend, Skye is ready for Amanda, or is it better to kind of follow Eddie's plan and have a couple more fights?
I mean, she feels ready.
Yeah.
Ready. So I'm guessing that she thinks she's developed herself enough to face her. Like you say, I don't feel like we've seen her against a higher pressure fighter enough. Like we've just discussed those kind of pressure fighters. Yeah. It'd be nice. So personally, no, I'd rather see her in with some more step ups first before she meets the, like we say, there's elite and then there's elite. And Amanda is top elite. So I personally think if I was managing her, then no, I wouldn't push her straight into that. I'm in between. But, you know, fighters, they think she's ready. Amanda gives it the go. I'd still watch that quite happily.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'd watch it all day. I mean, again, I think it's one of them, like logistically, it doesn't work. And obviously, we'll speak about Amanda's potential fight coming up. But, yeah, there's just so many good fights. So I think don't rush it. I'm always wary of, like, fighters rushing it. You know, she's only 10-0. She's got a world title now. Like, have a defence in Australia. I think that'd be great. Fight the likes of Raven Chapman. Massive fight. Maybe look to, you know, unify, whether obviously because we don't know what Amanda will be doing with her belts potentially. And then look to have the fight maybe next year. But obviously, I'm sure Skye is aware that Amanda's not going to be around forever. So I suppose it's that fine line, isn't it, to try and get that big fight in before she's retired, even though I've been saying for about a year, Amanda's going to retire. I think she was going to, and I think she's changed her mind, though, in my defence. So, obviously, that fight was at Las Vegas, and a couple of other fighters that were there was Claressa Shields and Alycia Baumgardner, and things got incredibly heated. I had like my pop. As soon as I saw that on Twitter, I was like, pause it, get the popcorn ready, feet up, cappuccino in hand, and I just watched it. It was so entertaining.
Do you know what? Claressa, every time, she is just on it with the the trash talk, with the arguments, with the head-to-head sort of face-offs. She's just fab, isn't she?
Yeah. I mean, it's quite a funny one because they become like friends in a way, didn't they?
They did.
And then, I mean, obviously you don't know the full ins and outs, but as far as I was aware, it was kind of like Alycia just mentioned that she'd like to have a fight with Claressa and it all kind of went downhill. But like it got heated, didn't it? Like you say, like Claressa is very good at that. I don't know if she likes to be confrontational, but it's part of the job and she's good at it. And we saw that against like Savannah Marshall as well, and it's entertaining. It sells, you know, I'm a big fan of it. It seems quite real as well. I'm not a fan when it's all like bullshit and you can tell it's fake. It seems quite real to me. Because I believe they got into an argument on a commercial flight once. And no one's really there. So that wasn't set up for anyone. So I'm all for it when it's real. But realistically, are they going to fight?
Just going back to being real or not, at first I thought it was fake because they were friends.
Yeah.
And you thought they were just building up. Like, oh, here we go. They're building it up. Just create some controversy to sell the fight. But like you say, I genuinely think it's real now. In terms of actually seeing the fight, I'm going to be a bit controversial here, so I don't really want to see it. Because I just feel like Alicia's just too small a fighter. There's too much of a gap in weight there. So it's not really a fight that I want to see, personally.
Yeah, I agree. Again, it's one of them I don't see happening. I would be shocked at that one. I think Alicia says she wants that 147. I think Claressa was saying 154. I don't even see Alicia going to 147 personally. I think I've said loads. She's just like a build is small, a height is small. I think it's all good and well, like fighters moving up. But sometimes we've seen now with some fighters that against certain opponents, you can probably get away with it. But when you're talking about the elite fighters, you can't just jump weights. It doesn't work. You know, divisions are there for a reason. it's not a fight I want to see. I think they're just completely different weight classes. I don't think there's any getting around that at all for me. But I'm here for the drama and 100%. To watch it. So that's good enough for me, to be fair. I'm quite happy with that. But yeah, I just, it's not in me that sees that fight happen. I just can't see it. You catch weight, nothing. I just don't know how it's happened.
No, I don't see it happening at all, really.
But we are here for it, so I'm more than happy to keep watching that drama, though, when they're both ringside. Sit there all day watching that.
And I still want to see Michaela Mayer, Alycia Baumgardner rematch, because I think that's where there's going to be some real fire there. And then with Claressa in Team Michaela Mayer, because obviously they're long-term friends, can you imagine the build-up for that one?
Do you know what? That is one of my favourite build-ups ever. Michaela Mayer, Alycia Baumgardner. And my favourite is when they're on Skye Sports and they shake hands and then, like, Alycia doesn't let go. And then Michaela makes a joke and, honestly, so much fun. And obviously it was a shame it got, like, postponed the first time around, but equally we got to watch that build-up twice. So it was, like, I was all there for that as well. Like, I absolutely lived for that build-up. It was incredible.
It was Alycia, like, eating ice creams and stuff as well, teasing Michaela about weight.
Yeah. And obviously she had, Alycia had that T-shirt made, didn't she, where she's walking a dog and it's like a picture of Michaela on it. And they're just the back and forth was unbelievable. And again, it was so real.
And the kicking.
And the what?
And Michaela Mayer kicking Alycia.
I was there. How did I forget that? I got a video of that. That was good from me. I was impressed with that. Yeah. I got some really, that was a good day actually, because Claressa was a bit wound up from the crowd at the, I think it was the weigh-in for that one or the press conference. Can't remember. And then, she was holding the belts, wasn't she, Michaela? And then Alycia pushed her and then she kicked her. Incredible. Oh, I would love to see that fight again and a trilogy and the one after. Yeah, I'm here for that one. Right, potential rematches being rumoured, Suzy. Katie Taylor, Amanda Serrano in Las Vegas in June. What are your thoughts on that one?
Well, we all want to see the rematch, but I just didn't expect it to suddenly... It felt like it's gone quiet. It was perhaps going to be Chantel Cameron trilogy. Now suddenly it's back on. I mean, in terms of the venue, the Sphere, that would be proper epic, the venue for that. I'm not sure how many it holds, but it looks pretty cool. But yeah, what's it going to be? You know, what weight?
That's my question. I don't get what's happened, because I don't get why Katie's vacated the lightweight titles to then want the Amanda fight.
It doesn't make sense, does it? So the only thing I can think of is it's going to be at whatever weight they want it to be for, regardless of belts, because it's just them against, you know, one against the other. But then is it going to be 12 threes? I don't know.
There's so many questions, isn't there, linked to this? The one thing I'm obsessed about is June is not far away. And I would have liked more notice, because I would like to go to this fight. And I feel like I need more notice for a Las Vegas fight, Suzy. I really do. Do you know what I mean? Like, what are we in now? April? May? I mean, that's too soon for me. So I will complain about that. But yeah, I've got so many questions. I don't understand the weight. If the fight is at 140, I'm nowhere near as excited as I'd like to be. I don't like that. I know everyone will go, oh, Amanda's a 7-weight world champion. And yes, she is.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, everyone knows I thought Amanda won the first time. I think lightweight is her peak when we're talking about, again, like, elite fighters. And there's weight divisions there for a reason. And you're talking featherweight is Amanda's, like, optimum. I'm not a fan of the 140. I'm not excited for that. Like you say, it could be a catch weight or 135 without the belts. And without a doubt, for me, that fight sells. I think you get, like we said last week, you get to a stage in your career where the belts don't mean everything. It's you and the other person in the ring. So I think for me, the weight is a bit baffling, though, with vacating them 140s. Whether, in my head, I feel like she was planning for the Chantel Cameron trilogy and something's happened along the way. But at that point, she's already vacated the lightweight belts. And I've never been convinced Katie Taylor would do 12 threes.
Mm. I have seen an interview somewhere where she said she was willing to do it, but that's one thing, saying it then and then actually following through.
Yeah, I'm just not convinced. But then, and I know Amanda says she'll only fight 12 threes. I do think the Casey-Taylor fight is different. I think you take that fight regardless of it. I think Casey's probably the one who wears the trousers and that type of fight, where she's going to have a little bit more of a say. And I'm sure Amanda wants that rematch, because I think she was incredibly close to winning the first time round, that she'd potentially do it. But there's just so many questions with that one. With it being linked to June, it's just, it's very close that, there's a lot of questions to be answered. But I'm excited for it, but I hope it's at 135. I wouldn't want it at 140.
I agree, because I just think it puts them both at a disadvantage, really, but especially Amanda Serrano. I don't think she'd agree to it, Serrano, to be honest.
No, it's a funny one. And my other thing is, I don't get what's happened to Croke Park, because June is the perfect time for a Croke Park fight. So I don't know, it's all just funny, isn't it? Because I just feel like it's all being built up for, like, the Croke Park fight and Chantel Cameron trilogy, and then it's all kind of at 140 undisputed, and now it's potentially, is she ever going to get that Croke Park fight? Because again, she's going to have to wait till the following summer, which is mental to me, because I really don't think she'll be fighting in 2025 summertime. Do you know what I mean? I don't know. I'd love to pick Eddie Hearn's brains on all of this and see what's gone on.
Yeah, there must be loads that's going on, like you say, but behind the scenes, but we just don't know.
Yeah, so it's all interesting. But either way, as long as she's in a good fight, Katie Taylor, then I'm all for it. Would love the Amanda Serrano rematch. Lucky enough to be there for the first one. Vegas. Love a bit of Vegas. Suits me, Vegas. Feel like I need to go.
We need someone to come along and pay for us. So if there's any sponsors out there that want to pay for Sasha to go out there and cover.
I will cover my own casino money. I will do that. I won't ask for anyone to do that.
I'll have some poker chips.
Yeah. but yeah, so I suppose we all have to watch this space for that fight. Right, Susie, there are two world title fights coming up this Saturday in Manchester on a Matchroom card. I think there's a unified fight that has massively, massively went under the radar for me. And funny enough, I was thinking it this morning and Ebony Bridges tweeted about it today. So Ellie Scotney against, who's she against, Susie?
Segolene. I won't butcher her surname, so sorry about that, Segolene. So we'll just leave it at a first name.
But this is a big fight. You know, we've got an 8-0 fighter against an 18-0 fighter. They both are coming in with a world title. So they're fighting for the IBF and WBO super bantamweight title. I think it's a massive fight that's kind of being a little bit forgotten about for some reason. I'm not sure why. How are you feeling about this fight?
Yeah, exactly the same. It is a real shame, because you see other fighters where there's press release after press release. There's, sponsor videos that are coming out, little like in-camp videos, all sorts of things building this up. We haven't seen anything, have we? Which is such a shame, because it is a huge fight, and Segolene is a real fighter and a real threat. If Ellie gets through Segolene on the weekend, it's going to be another statement for the division, really, in my opinion, because she's not going to take that belt easily from Segolene.
This is a massive fight. I mean, like you say, I mean, Segolene's 18-0, a very worthy world champion in her own right. I mean, it's a massive fight. I don't quite get it, to be fair. I mean, for me, Ellie Scotney, I absolutely love watching Ellie Scotney box. She is one of my favourite boxers to watch. I'm a massive fan. I think she will top the division. I think she'll be undisputed in multiple divisions in time to come. But I've just never felt like she's being pushed as much as potentially she should be, because I do believe she is like superstar material, Ellie Scotney. And she's also quite personable, quite a funny person as well.
Yeah.
So yeah, she kind of ticks a lot of the boxes, but I don't know whether sometimes it's like a fighter's choice. And I know obviously she's in Shane McGuigan's gym and they've kind of done their own, I know they've had like a docu-series out on TV. So whether it's been like an angle of they're going to do their own media and control the narrative a bit more. So I don't know whether it's like sometimes a conscious effort or whether Matchroom just, because I think Matchroom and all promotions are guilty of pushing certain amount of fighters and then other fighters just kind of plod along. So not too sure on that one, but I am really excited. And like you said before, if Ellie wins this, and I do think she'll get through it, but it'll be a really, really good fight to watch. That to me is a massive statement that everyone in the division needs to pay attention to Ellie Scotney if they're not already. Oh.
100%, 100%. Like you say, she's a worthy champion, Segolene. This is a real good fight, you know, really good matchup. It's going to, I'm really excited for it. And I think what I love, we've always said this about Ellie, she's been on a real journey, hasn't she, as a pro, where she, they took her weaknesses, not that she had many, but her little bits of weakness, and they just got the next fighter in that was like totally for that.
Yeah.
So she had to work on it and become stronger until she's become this sort of fighter she is today. And I think that's just brilliant how she's overcome that.
Yeah, I've loved her journey. Like you say, she's had a couple of fights where none of them have been easy. I think her step-ups have been perfect. I think she's done everything at the exact right time. I think she's been managed very well. And like you say, if she's shown a weakness in one fight, they will bring in an opponent to make sure that she corrects that weakness. And like you say, there wasn't many to begin with, but I think already she's near enough like the full package for me as a boxer. And she's still so young, she's only 8-0, but she, in my opinion, is definitely like a superstar in the making, without a doubt.
And I think if she with the way that Segolene fights, I think if she puts on the pressure, she's gonna turn out to be the unified champion at the weekend.
Yeah.
I think she's got a lot of pressure on Segolene.
Yeah, like I say, I'm really looking forward to this one. It's going to be a close fight, but yeah, without a doubt, I'm going for Ellie Scotney. And then there's big things to come, but that is definitely a fight to tune in for. And on the same card at the weekend is Rhiannon Dixon, who is going for her first world title. So she's currently 9-0. She is facing Karen, I'm going to pronounce her name wrong, Carabajal, is that right?
I'd go for that.
Carabajal. I say it so unconfident. but we do know Karen from facing Katie Taylor a few years back, and that is her only loss. However, I wouldn't probably say her opponents have always been at the highest of levels, to be fair. But this is a good opponent, I think, for Rhiannon Dixon for this first world title.
Yeah, it's a tough opponent, actually. You know, an Argentinian fighter is always going to be tough because they, you know, you can pretty much guarantee how they fight. They'll be tough. I mean, she's never been stopped. She's going to be, you know, it's a tough as nails. She's going to come forward. She's going to put the pressure on. So basically, Rhiannon's got a work cut out for her. But I believe Rhiannon can do it. But she's going to be, another hard, brilliant fight to watch.
Yeah, I think it's going to be an entertaining fight. Again, I'm a fan of Rhiannon Dixon. Love watching her box. Her improvements, every fight, have been incredible as well. She is getting better and better and looks better and better against these higher-level opponents. So I think it's going to be a great fight to watch, but I think we'll see the best version of Rhiannon Dixon. And I am quite confident that she will be a world champion come Saturday night.
Yes. And like you say, her footwork has been brilliant, how that's come along, how she sort of turns around the opponents and cuts the corners. You know, that's something to watch.
Yeah, she's definitely a quick learner, isn't she? Because like we say, she's not got a massive amateur pedigree. She actually come from white collar, so white collar to world champion. Love that narrative as well.
Yes. And I put out a tweet and an Instagram post earlier, I don't know if you caught it, she was the first person to ever be interviewed on our channel.
No way, I didn't know she was the first.
Yeah, so she's come from being the very first to now going for her first world title. So that's something.
We're part of her journey, Susie.
Well, that's it.
Right, the favourite bit of the podcast, Susie, knockout of the week. Are you going positive or negative this week?
Do you know what? I did a negative last week, and unfortunately, I'm going to go for a negative again.
Becoming a habit.
Oh, but, you know, it was because I noticed with the fight with Skye Nicolson against Sarah Mahfoud, it was just a little irritation, not just with their fight, but with lots of fights recently. Is fighters wearing the same fight colour. Now, I know that there's supposed to be some sort of ruling where they tell the, you know, tell people what they're going to wear, so there's no sort of clash. But I feel like it must have become slack lately, because I feel like every fight that we see, they always seem to sort of have some sort of psychic connection with their opponent and wear the same colours.
And why does that upset you?
Because it's just not as nice to watch, I think. It's quite nice to see.
People need to be like Michaela Mayer and plan like six months in advance, like what their fight colour is going to be.
I mean, she's a dream to watch. We know what colour. She's always a different colour to her opponent.
And if her opponent come out in the same colour, they've done that on purpose, because she literally tells her fight fans, like, straight away, like, I'm red this time, and, like, everyone knows.
And, like, for instance, Skye had a really lovely outfit, you know, the black and the gold. And then because her opponent was also in the black and gold, they had to have those, I mean, I don't know if they were going to do it anyway, but it felt like they did it on purpose. It was purposely put blue and red tape around their gloves, so that it was like, there's the red corner, there's the blue corner more clearly. And it kind of ruins the outfit then.
So moving forward, we need everyone to be a little bit more kind of clinical in that, don't we, for you? So fighters need to be planning. It should be signed in the contract. What's your fight colour going to be?
Yeah, because I know that they are meant to tell some, I don't know which person it is they're supposed to say, but they are supposed to in advance say what colours to avoid it. But like I said, it must have just got to the point where people don't mind anymore, except me.
Not from you. okay, I mean, it made me laugh when you said you were going to say that one, because I'd never really thought about it, and now it's one of them, like, it's all I'm going to notice. It's like when you don't hear a noise, but then someone mentions it, it's all you can hear. But yeah, I don't think it certainly doesn't upset me like it upsets you, but we'll see. Now that I notice it, maybe it will.
I hope I've not ruined it for you now, because then you'd be like, oh, look at it again and again.
I wouldn't even be able to pay attention to the fight now, because I'd be like, oh my God, they're in the same colour shorts. Turn it off. I'm going for a negative one this week. I'm doing it. I'm copying you. So my knockout of the week is commentators throughout a female fight mentioning that it's 10 2-minute rounds. Because we know. Like, I feel like it's fine to mention it at the beginning. And I do believe American commentators are so much more guilty to this, because throughout that fight with Skye Nicolson, they said far too many times, like, oh, 2-minute rounds, they go quick. It's like, oh, we know. And it's like, right, this bout is for 10 2-minute rounds. And like I say it at the beginning, but it's like every round. And it's, and like, 2-minute rounds are hard to score. 2-minute rounds, this 2-minute round. And I just think, like, we get it's 2 minutes. I don't know if we have to keep mentioning it during a fight. And it's all the time. And I do think the American commentators are a lot more guilty of doing it, because you'll notice that a lot now that I've mentioned it. Yeah. Like, go back and watch that fight. But I was like, Jesus Christ, we know. Like, it was just doing me head in at one point. And it was just, when they were like, you know, the 2-minute rounds are hard to score, I'm not being funny, that fight wasn't overly difficult to score, was it? I mean, it was kind of the same as the first 10 seconds was the same as the rest of it. You could probably score it quite quick. So I feel like there needs to be a cap on that. Like, maybe mention it at the beginning of the fight in case you do have new fight fans watching and they're not sure. And then I think after that, like, it gets fucking boring, so we don't need to do it anymore.
You've created a new drinking game.
No, honestly, if you had a shot of tequila every single time a commentator mentioned in a female bout that it was 10 2-minute rounds, you would be shit-faced. I'm telling you. It is outrageous how often they say it. There we go. Drinking game for everyone.
But
obviously, I'll be on sparkling water, but I'll still play.
Did you notice as well in this Nisra Estrada fight that they put up the wrong time to begin with in the first round? Because it really confused me as to what they were doing. So they put up 3 minutes, and then after about a minute, they realised and quickly shot it down to a minute.
Oh, I didn't even notice that. Kiara. I mean, I can't even remember in that fight. I'm gonna honestly watch them back, but try and watch them on like an American link and count how many times they'll say it. It will blow your mind. It is incredible. So that is my knockout of the week, but I'm hoping something positive next week. Hard in boxing sometimes, though.
All these little niggly things.
Yeah, and like the commentary can get my back up at the best of times, to be fair. So probably I'm not nitpicking there, but honestly, I reckon now I've said it, people will notice it and they'll be on board. They'll agree with both of us. People will be getting upset about the shorts as well now.
Now, I wouldn't mind if someone's out there that wants to try this and having a drinking game of it. Do a little record and tag us in onto social media.
Just don't blame us for a hangover the next day.
Don't like, not encouraging drinking. Like we said, you could have water.
Yeah, definitely. Right, that is it. I am hoping when we are back next week, we might have news on like Katie Taylor and Amanda Serrano. I'm hoping that there's going to be some like major news that we're going to drop. And also, we'll discuss obviously the fights at the weekend as well, because I'm really, really looking forward to them world title fights.
Yes. Yeah, definitely tune in to these two fights on the weekend because they are set to be very, very good fights.
Yeah, 100%. Right, as always, it has been a pleasure. I'm gonna catch you next week. See how many steps you get in, Susie. Best of luck. I'll beat you this week, probably.
I've just been dedicating the rest of my week to trying to beat Sasha.
Yeah, we won't be on social media this week because we're walking and you're cycling, apparently. So you're cheating. Right, thank you. I just feel like that should have been pre-agreed, to be fair, but thank you all for watching. Make sure that you like, subscribe, share, let us know your knockouts of the week. I know someone did tweet us to say their knockout of the week was Katie Taylor and Amanda Serrano, which is a good positive one, but I'm gonna hold off on that until it's officially announced. Can't be too optimistic in boxing. Dangerous. Right, we will catch everyone next week.
Yes. See ya.
Bye.